My name is Komal. I'm assistant curator and I'm in charge of the jewelry collection at the National Museum. And I'm absolutely thrilled and excited to be with all of you. I'm also seeing the comments. It's so nice to see everybody. So what I have decided for today's talk is that, as you know, it is titled Facets of Indian Jewelry, Narratives, Representation and Interpretation. So instead of taking a jewelry class for everybody, which nobody would have liked, I have decided that I am going to pull out stories, narratives, interpretation that we keep hearing about. We already know that, but we have not paid attention to the jewelry detail that it contains. So without further ado, let me just jump right into the presentation. So I hope it is clear. I hope you can see it. I am showing a PPT from my laptop, actually. And the first image that I begin with, that I start with, is a Gajalakshmi lamp. Now, I thought this will be a nice way to recreate a live session, because every time we have a program in the museum, we start it by lighting a lamp. And it would be nice, we have never lit this lamp, but we can do it virtually now. What you're seeing on your screens is a beautiful early 20th century gold lamp, which has Gajalakshmi made on it in repoussé work. And there are two, three ideas, like why I am talking about lamp here is, of course, to mark the beginning of my presentation. But at the same time, the idea of a lamp is related to the idea of light. And light has, various interpretations, various understanding. And one of the interpretation of light is also beauty. So when we say light, we also mean noor. Noor means beauty. And so in the Brahmanical traditions, we have this custom of lighting a lamp. But in the Buddhist traditions, very interestingly, you have a Prakrit saying that goes like Appo Deepo Bhava. You yourself should become a lamp. So in, weaving through these small anecdotes from Islam, from Buddhism, from Hinduism, from Jainism, and so many other things that are there in the Indian tradition, the heterogeneous Indian tradition, I would carry forward my presentation. I'll be very happy to take your questions if you have. The next slide that I take you to now is this beautiful Shalabhandrika that is there in the museum. Let me take my mobile a little more closer so that you can see it. So this is a beautiful Shalabhandrika that's in the museum. And I will not go into the art history of it right now, because my interest in every sculpture and every painting that I see is about the jewelry that is there. And if you look carefully, I'll have to move this. If you look carefully, she's wearing an ornament which has got two amulets attached to it. And if you look more closely, these amulets have carvings on them. So there's a face. You can see that these are the two eyes and the face. So which also means that jewelry in the Indian context is not something only material. It is not something that you can just, put on and wear it. It's not only material, but it is something that is enliven. It is something that has life. And this sculpture that dates around, I think, 200 years before the Christ was born, tells us how jewelry was perceived within the Indian tradition. Otherwise, this is a very rare sight to see, that jewelry is manifested. And it has got human manifestation. And with that, I would like to now talk about... I would now like to talk about... The second thing, we have seen how jewelry was manifested, and now we look at the people the wearers of this jewelry. Now, with every ornament that is there, there is a mood of the ornament. There is mood of ornamentation. Like the Kritika sculpture that we see over here is of a lady who is wearing a very gentle smile on her face. So jewelry is not only about wearing an ornament, but also things like how she's shown smiling, very gentle smile, or a woman's bust like this, which has got a very noble, serene expression, but of course she's bejeweled. But what I'm trying to bring home is the fact that jewelry is something that adds on to the wearer also the flavor. Again, going back to the Indian sculptures, we have this lady who's looking at herself in the mirror, which also tells us about a lot of other things that are associated to jewelry, like appearance, look, aesthetics. And on the other side, over here, we have a lady on whose hand there is a parrot playing. It is perching on her bangles. So this everything like so adds on to the idea of jewelry. So it is not something limited to only wearing, but the wearer and the ornament together, they speak something, they say something. Now, most of the slides, most of the presentation material that you're going to see here is something that I have taken from sculptures and paintings. And with that, why am I doing that? To tell you that I will take you back to 5th century CE, that is around the Gupta period. And over there, we have this Vishnu Dharmottar Puran that is written, and this marks the crystallization of Indian iconography. And over there, the text is very interesting. It starts with this Vajra and Markandeya talking to each other. And to sum it up, I have the slide there, but to sum it up, King Vajra asks Markandeya that, okay, how can I be a good sculptor? So he says, for sculpting, you have to know painting. Then he says, how can I be a good painter? He says, for painting, you have to know music. How can I be a good musician? For music, you have to know singing. So which tells us that the whole of Indian art, the 64 forms of Indian art, they are all interrelated. Nothing can be seen in a watertight compartment, not even jewelry. Where the jewelry is kept, who's wearing it, in which social context, all these things become equally important when we are looking at jewelry. I will show you the next slide. So this here for you, I have brought the photograph of the jewelry gallery, which is absolutely empty right now. There is nothing happening there. But what we did when I became the custodian of the collection and we were setting up the jewelry gallery, we had a director general, Dr. Mani, who decided that the Pitalkhora Yaksha should be placed right in the center of the jewelry gallery. And now, why does this sculpture become so essential to anything that is related to jewelry is that this Pitalkhora Yaksha on his outer right palm over here that I have zoomed in bears an inscription called Kanha Dasena Hiram Karena Kato, which means Kanha Dasa, who calls himself Hiram Karen, the jeweler, the person who works in gold, goldsmith, has carved this Yaksha figure. Now, this is so fascinating that nowhere in the world do we have a parallel of something like a Yaksha, which gives us the name of a goldsmith from 2nd century BCE. And there is no better example than this that talks about how celebrated the jewelry arts were in the Indian context. And I would have said this in the starting, but I would like to dedicate my lecture to Kannadasa, who is there with us now in his spirits and is sort of rejoicing that he's being talked about right now in a live session. So having said that, generally when you see that, okay, National Museum is doing something on jewelry, you would imagine that I would start from the Indus Valley jewelry, which is of course there in our collection, or I'll be talking about the Takshila jewelry, which is also there in our collection. The gold that you're seeing on your screens right now is from 1st century CE. So you can imagine the craftsmanship. And what you're seeing on your screens now is the latest piece that the museum has acquired. So from the Harappa till what we have acquired 2 years ago, we have an expansive collection that is there. However, National Museum time and again keeps displaying the Nizam jewelry. So, but it would have become very classroom-like, you know, to talk about, to tell you, okay, this object is this, it is this century. So I decided that I'll just pluck stories from whatever I have studied in art history and then tell you what this whole charisma of jewelry is. So what you're seeing on your screens right now, a lot of you have already must have identified it. It is the Jacob diamond, which is a part of the Nizam's jewelry collection. And we have a Satlada. Satlada is the pearl that you are seeing, the pearl necklace. And it is called Satlada because it has got seven strings of pearls attached to it. And a little more closely, if you look at it, it is a beautiful piece. It was my favorite piece in the Nizam's collection. Is that you look at the grading of the pearls. Very carefully, the jeweler, the craftsman, has gone to arrange them in an order like this, that they are moving in, that they are, there's a difference in size of this pearl to this pearl that is there. And of course, more than 100 carats, I don't need to speak anything else about the Jacob diamond. Probably in some another session, I will tell you about all the fascinating stories that are related to diamonds. But coming back to my methodology, my style of dealing with it. Basically jewelry becomes something that is said to be capturing light. It is something inside which the light enters and it radiates. And what happens with the radiation, the person who's wearing it, remember we were talking about how jewelry affects the wearer, it affects the person who wears it. Now on your screens, what you're seeing are the Bodhisattva figures, and Bodhisattva figures are there in the Buddhist pantheon, and they are highly, highly bejeweled figures. Now, who's a Bodhisattva? To answer it very, very quickly, Bodhisattva is someone who delays his enlightenment to help the others. So these are the Bodhisattvas that you're seeing on your screens right now, and they are heavily, heavily bejeweled. Another example are these Bodhisattva heads. Now, why do I talk about them after talking about the radiating light of the jewels? Is that all the Bodhisattvas that you will see, they wear a headband, something like this that you're seeing here. Now, it takes us back to one of the Jataka stories, the Kushaka Jataka, that tells us that once there was a man who really wanted to meditate and, you know, get the Bodhisattva hood, but he could not. He couldn't become a Buddha. And then what happens is this, that he meets a Yaksha once, and the Yaksha tells him, I will turn it this side, and the Yaksha tells him that, you are not worthy of enlightenment because you are very ugly. So the only solution is that, why don't you do one thing? Why don't you tie a pearl string on your forehead? Now, when the pearls will radiate, they will glow and they will make you worthy of enlightenment. This is how the idea of light, the idea of enlightenment, the idea of jewelry being worthy of virtues also is highlighted. So now that we are talking about Bodhisattvas, I would want to draw your attention to this Buddha sculpture. We all know that Buddha is somebody who renounced the world. He renounced everything that he had. He decided to go in search of truth and enlightenment, and for that he had to give away his regal status. Now what you have on your screens is this beautiful panel that tells us, you can see Chandaka when Buddha leaves on Chandak and goes. But of my interest here is this particular, the top part that I have zoomed in for you, is this that, I'm sorry, is it clear? Okay. Is this that in the center, what you see is Indra, and what he has on his head is a basket on which there is a crown. So now when Buddha gives away, gives away everything that he has, all the worldly affairs, he also, because he was a prince, he used to wear a crown, and he also gives away that crown, and he starts moving. And when that time, crowns used to be royal turbans, and the moment he removes his royal turban, there are some bit of his hair relics, hair that are stuck to it. And it is said that when Buddha was about to keep the crown down, it sort of floats and it goes up in the air. And it is Indra, let me take you to Indra, and it is Indra who gets it over there. And this is a panel that you will, if you have visited the National Museum, this is there in the Buddha Gallery. And this is that particular moment, that particular scene when this jewel turban of Buddha has just arrived in the heaven. You can see everybody either joining hands in adoration, or there is music, dance, and everybody is sort of coming towards it to look at the crown once, to look at this jeweled turban once. And then you have, of course, then comes the Pala period around 12th century, where you start seeing Buddha, he is bejeweled even in the Bhumi Sparsha Mudra. So Bhumi Sparsha Mudra is when the moment of enlightenment, Buddha calls Mother Earth to witness his enlightenment. I have zoomed in that part for you. But interestingly, he is shown crowned here. He had removed it. Remember, this is how Buddha attains the Buddhahood. And goes, and he has already removed the crown, but then suddenly you see it on him again. You see it, he's heavily, heavily bejeweled. He's wearing necklace, he's wearing a bazu band, he's wearing a very, very stunning crown, which also, if you see, has these grooves in which the gemstones would have been attached. And this is again another example of the Pala period, where the Buddha, who had renounced everything, is suddenly shown crowned. Now, where does this arrive from? Where does this idea arrive from, that despite of Buddha having renounced the world, why are we seeing him crowned? So there is a story that when he ultimately goes to the heaven, he's crowned over there. But more than that, what is fascinating, to show him crowned as early as when he's getting enlightened, tells us the love that the Indian sculptor, or the Indian psyche, or the Indian mindset had, that they couldn't see their god without any jewelry. So they had to put, so even if it is austere, even if it is a serene scene, even if it is something that Buddha renounces everything, suddenly he's shown bejeweled. After this, I will draw your attention to the next sculpture that I have on my screen. Again, if you've come to the National Museum, I'm sure you have seen this. This is a beautiful Garud image. It's simple, and a lot of people try to look at this idea of salutation that he has over there. But what has interested me about this sculpture is his jewelry. Now, if you see carefully, I am going to pulled it like this. Yeah. Now, I have zoomed in this part for you to see that he's wearing snakes around his neck. He could have worn any other beads. He could have worn the Tulsi beads like the way Vishnu is shown, but he's shown wearing this. So this takes us back to the classic idea of how there is an animosity between Garud and snakes. We all know about this animosity, that Garud is anti-snakes, and here Garud decides to be somebody that he's going to make his enemy into an ornament and wear him around his neck to show the virtue, to show the power. Also, every jewelry that is worn in whichever body part has a different sort of course, it has poetics, but it also has a politics of its own. How does it happen that you're wearing, like, the idea of varmal that is there, the idea of owning up somebody that is there? So here what we see, I'm going to turn it, is how the Garud decides to own up the snake that is his enemy and wear it around the neck. The second example that I have is of Narasimha. If you have come to the museum, you have seen this also. So Narasimha here, interestingly, we all know the story, so I will not go into the details of the story, but he's killing the Rakshasa Hiranyakashyap. And if you look at it carefully, what I have pulled out for you, like a zoomed in version, that he removes the intestines of the demon. And this is a beautiful Tanjore painting that you can see on your screens right now, which shows that moment which I just showed you in sculpture, that how Narasimha actually pulls out the intestines of Hiranyakashyap. And if this is the pulling out scene, and here you see Narasimha wearing it around his neck. And this tells the power of jewelry. This tells that jewelry is not something dainty, pretty, and only beautiful, but jewelry has so much more. It has that power. It can convey politics of different types. And so here, and there are more instances of it, that, you know, once Narasimha pulls out the intestine and wears it around his neck, he does the famous dance. He does a tandava. But how can we forget the jewelry that we have in our collection? Of course, we don't have intestines, but I would like to draw your attention to most beautiful necklaces that we have in our collection. They are my favorites. And here you have something which is from Banaras, and here you have something which is from Rajasthan and is a Mughal style jewelry. And if I get more time later on or more sessions, I would like to go into the details of their craftsmanship. But quickly, I would like to draw your attention to, you know, how does the craftsmanship happens in gold? If you see these again in receding size, these emeralds that are put. Now, in the Indian, for the Indian jeweler, it was not necessary, you know, to cut and chisel and make stones very micro, but they also learned how to use the found gems as they were found, as it is. So the very less chiseling, very less wasting of the gemstone would happen, which makes it very different from the Victorian style of jewelry, which is this. So this is also from the Nizam's collection, and if you look at it carefully, all the diamonds have been chiseled to the minute sizes and put together. So somebody is just asking me why. I would like to say that I feel that the idea of design in context of Indian jewelry was based on the gemstone. So there was more importance that was given to the gemstone. There was less importance that the jeweler was paying to himself. So he would weave the design, he would imagine the designs based on what the gemstone was and how it looked and how he could attain the perfection in shape, size, aesthetics by chiseling it the least, which we don't see in this over here. Moving on to more necklaces, more neck ornaments that we have in our collection, you see beautiful, stunning pieces from Rajasthan. You can see how pearls have been fastened at the ends of it to make it more animated. This one, what you see here, is called an arya. It is put on the neck and comes till below down. I can give you a closer look if you wish to. And these. Moving on to the next slide. Now, I think I should begin with this one. You can excuse my order. So what you're seeing on your screens are two beautiful, beautiful bangles that are there in our collection. And if you see, the most celebrated peacock and the parrot are enameled on these. Now, this has intrigued me a lot, the idea of wearing jewelry, the idea of wearing bangles. And if you may notice, this is something which is very, very peculiar to the Indian subcontinent. And what I have here is, if you look at it carefully, we also know that when the Britishers had come, they would go document the Indian professions. And this is a churiwala, a person who comes to sell bangles, and you know, he's putting bangles in her hands. And this is an example from one of the sites that I went to in Karnataka. And it is so beautiful. If you see that on the door jamb of the temple, you have this couple and a very beautiful zoomed in portion. I would like to show you that he's holding the bangle in his hand and putting in the hand of the lover, if you can see. This is spoken about so many times in Bollywood, in other, you know, poetry, in Hindi poetry, in Urdu poetry, this whole thing about bangles and lovers being attached to each other. And this is an example of how the lover is actually putting it on his own into her hand. But we may think it is now, but here is the Rakhi Gadi skeleton that is there at the National Museum. And if you notice carefully, the skeleton is wearing ivory bangles. Any time that people ask me that kya leke aaye ho, kya leke aajaoge, what have you got into this world and what will you take? I'm sure that from today onwards, we can say that I will take the bangle back with me, because here lies the person who's buried, the lady who's buried with her bangles on her. And we might feel that bangle is something that is associated only on women, but cults like Sikhism, they also talk about kada, that is there, that the men wear. So this is my favorite. And now very quickly I'll tell you about the bangles, the kadas that we have in our collection. What you see here is from the south of India. What you see here are very tiny bangles, probably for a child in the family. And what you see here is a beautiful, you know, coming together of craftsmanship of fastening these tiny rice pearls into the bangle, which is enameled. Now, talking about this piece. Now, whenever I looked at this piece, I would always wonder that this is just a plain, and mind you, this weighs around 0.5 kgs of gold, absolute. And I would just wonder that who's going to wear this, you know, this heavy thing, which is like a, it is as if I'm being punished by wearing it. So then came this beautiful anecdote that every time, we know that in India, we have had multiple styles of art that flourished. And then we come to this idea that anybody who wore, like the royals who would wear jewelry like this, which was very heavy, was not really meant to be worn. Then why was it there? It was there because every time the royals would go to see a royal performance, be it music, dance, painting, or any sort of artistry, and if the artist could win the heart of the king or the royals, this was immediately given out as a gift. Now, anybody over here who knows that when we go to buy jewelry, we spend a lot of money into its making charges. And sometimes they are so much that it becomes double the price of the gold. So here, very intelligently, the way the kada has been has been designed, the whole idea has been to keep the gold in it alive. So no chiseling, no cutting, no wasting of anything, just making the kada, which will be given away as a gift, as a praise to somebody, to take it so that they may not wear it, but sell it later on to buy things from it. So it is almost like a gold biscuit, but in a form of jewelry. And again, what you have on your screen, I thought I will also keep throwing light on craftsmanship. What you have here is a beautiful kada that is there. I couldn't show you a better image, a better zoomed in image, but this is a crocodile. The makara head terminals are there in this kada. And what you see here are, can you see the two tongues of these? They are made of real rubies. So for the gold craftsman to imagine that the crocodiles, if I'm making, I'm going to put the ruby tongues over here, would have been quite a thing. But at the same time, we have something like this, which is from Banaras. And a quick tip to everybody who doesn't know much about jewelry but is fascinated by it, even I don't know much, I'm learning, is that the moment you see the pink enamel, you can identify it as Gulabi Meena from the craftsmanship that happens in Banaras. And interestingly, here we have the elephant heads. So it's exciting how the animal figures also got incorporated into the design that was there. And of course, there is a lot of symbolic value that is attached to these. Once again, a beautiful, stunning Tanjore painting. And sometimes if you are very fortunate, you know, we have the kada with us and we see the kada in the painting as it is. This is one of the rare, opportunities that are there. Now, a little I would like to talk about that, what else would have this jewelry meant. So interestingly, in the Indian context, we had this thing where we would worship the nine planets, the Navagrahas were worshipped, the celestial bodies that are up in the sky. And time and again in temple architecture, we see that how there is a specific, you know, location, how there is they are allocated a special place within the temple architecture, and which means that people would worship, pray to these celestial bodies so that they are perfectly aligned for the well-being of the person. And what you have on your screen right now is a beautiful temple lintel, a lintel from a temple which shows the Navagraha aligned together, put here. And what is fascinating is that we have jewelry. So every Navagraha, every gem that was there got associated, every planet that was there got associated to a gem. And here we have the beautiful, one of our masterpieces, Navratna necklace over here. And what I have done is to show you which is what, I have just done a little bit of labeling. I hope this doesn't get boring if I tell you, but Hezonite for Rahu, yellow sapphire for Jupiter, emerald for Mercury, blue sapphire for Saturn, ruby in the center. Always remember that ruby is going to be in the center of any Navratna jewelry that you see. Diamond for Venus, pearl for Moon, coral for Mars, and cat's eye for Ketu. Now, isn't it very fascinating that there is this idea of worshipping the celestial being? And later on, the jewelry that you were seeing was around 19th century. And how this gets carried on to the jewelry. This is the love that Indians have had for jewelry. And what happens in the course of it is this, that not only is the planet important, the gemstone important, but on your screen, this. And for those who know it, this is Akbar, who's sitting with his nine gems. विच ऑल्सो मीन्स दैट ज्वेलरी वॉज समथिंग दैट गॉट एसोसिएटेड टू पीपल. The idea of gem being, you know, he's a gem-like person, she's a gem-like person, things like that got associated. And one of the nine gems of Akbar that you may know is Mia Tansen, who was a singer in his court. So how the idea of, you know, the Navagrahas gets translated into gemstones. And then we have this idea that there are the kings, the courts have this culture of having nine gems in them. And also you'll be interested to know that it was during Akbar's period that, you know, the idea of nine gems became very crucial, became very, very interesting. And he followed it. Akbar would have one dress for every day, given the day. And something like this is to show you that how rich was the craftsmanship. This is a very late piece, which is from Bengal, and what we see here, we call this a spring necklace. Spring not in terms of season but in terms of its craftsmanship. And if I show it to you give you a closer look, so what you see is that each gemstone is attached to one flower, and each flower is placed on a spring. So the person who would wear it, you can just imagine the person who would wear it and move around, how every flower would dazzle, every flower would get animated, and this would add, you know, the idea of motion into the jewelry, and there was a tremor that was there that animated this jewelry. We have already seen this. Now that we are talking about Navratnas, we are talking about appeasing the you know, celestial bodies, we also have this idea that jewelry was not only meant for wearing, but it was also meant to ward off the evil. It was meant to protect the person. It was meant as, there was also a sense of protection. So what you have on your screens right now is a a yogini, which is there at the National Museum, if you've seen it. And what, like I was saying, that sometimes we get lucky. This is a amulet that we have in our collection. And interestingly, it has tiger claws attached to it, if you can see over here. And if I would take you back to the yogini, she's wearing a similar thing which has got tiger claws attached to it. So jewelry is also something that shows power. Jewelry is also something that shows a statement. And don't miss her very, very bold anklets that she's wearing. So again, another specimen of how jewelry would ward off the evils is this, which is amulets. And in repoussé work, if you see carefully, there are gods and goddesses that are made onto it. And one of the pendants, I don't have a better picture, I'm so sorry. One of the ornaments, one of these smaller amulets has Sitla Devi made on it. If you can see carefully, these are the Shripada, the feet of Vishnu that are made on it. So now I think I will end my presentation with this. But before you go away, I would like to give you a teaser of what my next session is going to be about. So we have discussed everything, but I just want to tell you that sometimes, you know, flowers to jewelry, fresh flowers. And you have this lady who's plucking fresh flowers here. I'm going to be talking about Vasant Sena, who wears those fresh flowers on her hair, and there is this whole story of Mitchukatikam that I'm going to be discussing next time. I am going to be talking about fabulous examples of painted jewelry, where smaller miniature paintings were done and put into the jewelry frames. I am going to be talking about how gemstones were carved to show the faces of the gods. I'm going to be talking about rings, about Radha and Krishna, and about how when Sita waits in the Ashokvatika, Hanuman comes. And of course, I'm going to be talking about this beautiful masterpiece of painting from the National Museum. But I'm not going to be talking about Jahangir or Madonna, but I'm going to be talking about the earring that Jahangir wears and why does he wear that. So, very quickly, I would like to sum up with this whole idea that how this is what you see on your screen right now is how the plants, Kalpalata, how the plants would also bear the three ratnas. So we are from a place, the Indian subcontinent, which has totally explored the length and breadth of the jewelry. And here you see the Kalpalata, the plant that gives jewelry. And jewelry and more, stay tuned with me. I'm going to be again online on 2nd of May at 4 p.m. And till then, stay safe, stay at home. I'm sure everybody already knows enough. I don't need to speak much about COVID. But keep thinking about jewelry, keep dreaming about jewelry. Think of all the jewelries that you have at home. Probably we can do some nice exercise in one of the sessions. And Meet Our Curator series is an effort of the National Museum where we curators from home are coming to your home. And we all are trying this for the first time. We are all very excited for it. And I hope this whole effort that the National Museum is putting is going to be of help and, you know, entertainment most importantly to all of you. Thank you so much.